Hey, I'm Dale Likens, the pastor of a new open affirming congregation in the Mason area called the Open Table. Our website is theopentablechurch.org. I encourage you to go there and find out more information about us, connect with us in other ways, see what we're about, what we are doing month in and month out during this pandemic time, and how we are staying connected with each other and with God. You'll find some information about missional communities, which we encourage you to be a part of. So just click on that and find out what those are about and how, and we'll connect you with one if you're interested. Also, you'll find how we are living our monthly rhythm of up in out, or loving God, loving ourselves, and loving others. And so I encourage you to check that out. You know, during this pandemic time, it has been, you know, I find that I have some time to fill. Not that I've not been busy, but, you know, Shelly and I are going out less. Well, we're not going out at all. And so there's just things about, you know, especially weekends, like, well, how are we going to spend our time? And we have been doing puzzles, jigsaw puzzles. We've got one right here on the table right now that we are working on. And I was thinking about that this morning. Today, in this worship video, we're going to hear a story. It's kind of reminded me of a jigsaw puzzle. You may not know, you know, you kind of have the end picture in mind because it's given to you, but then there are all these pieces you're not sure where they fit. But in this story from the Gospel of Mark today, God helps fit some of the pieces together and reveals the fuller picture.
We'll do it all, everything on our own. We don't need just lay here. Would you lie with me and just forget the world? I don't quite know how to say how I feel. Said too much, they're not enough. If I lay here, if I just lay here, would you lie with me and just forget the world? Forget what we're told before we get too old. Show me a garden that's bursting into life. Let's waste time chasing cars around our heads. I need grace to remind me to find my home. If I lay here, if I just lay here, would you lie with me and just forget the world? Into life. I can see. I don't know where, confused about how as well. Just know these things will never change for us at all. If I lay here, if I just lay here, would you lie with me and just forget the world?
Please join me in prayer. We pray for the people of the world whose names we will never know, whose faces flash across the TV screen in anonymity born of numbers, who bear the weight of Earth's pain. We are in need of a glimpse of Jesus, who is the truth that love is stronger than hate, peace is possible, and life can emerge even in the midst of devastation. We pray for that truth to be known. We are in need of a glimpse of Jesus, who is the life, inviting us to follow in his footsteps as he trod the way of love and justice, inviting us to follow him in prayer as he lived out his faith and made you known. We give thanks for the good news that unfolds in the world as people dream your dreams, follow your nudging, and seek you in the faces they meet each day. For all those who are quiet witness to your love and way of life, we give thanks, O God. Open us to your light that we might see ourselves clearly, with all our fears and faults and faith, with all our desires and dreams and duties. Help us to see our journey as a place of your appearing, and we may come down from the mountain and set one foot in front of the other, in your name and for your sake. Amen.
Mark chapter 9, verses 2 through 9, the Transfiguration. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead.
God can seem so confusing. God is distant. God is up there, far away, way up there somewhere. God is angry and needs to be moved by us to act on our behalf. We need to get everything right, or God will be lost to us forever. Those are some things we tell ourselves about God. Sometimes we believe them very strongly, and it's reinforced by other people's theological perspectives. But today, we hear a story from the writings of Mark in the New Testament that show us a different narrative about God than the one we often tell ourselves or have heard told over and over again so much that it becomes part of our personal beliefs too, even if we don't know why. You see, in Mark, Jesus takes three disciples to a mountaintop. He wants to spend some time in prayer and just to get away from the crowds that are always finding them. And while they are there on retreat, Jesus is changed before them. It's really all we can say. It's a story that, you know, this image that is hard to explain. Jesus is before them and they see this dazzling spectacle. And here in this moment, Jesus and these disciples in this strange story that Mark records, this strange story that would be very easy to skip over, and we often do, but in this moment, God unveils. God gets real and shows these followers of Jesus what's behind the curtain. It's recorded that Jesus is dazzling bright with light. I mean, how awesome that God did not leave us humans in the dark. Instead, God shines brightly. God speaks to us. God shows up in all God's glory, continuing what God started at Christmas. God shows up in the human story and becomes vulnerable. I mean, it's a vulnerable thing to reveal yourself, to unveil. I mean, in a sense, God is exposed. That's how much God loves us. God loves us so much and wants to show us how much God loves us, that God strips away all pretense and falsehood, all the things that we make up, the stories we tell ourselves that must certainly be true, even if they're not. So God strips all that away and reveals truth. And that is how much God loves us. I can't say it enough. You see, Christians believe that in Jesus, God has come to meet us. Christianity is a revealed religion, which, as Will Willimon says, means that its faith comes to us rather than arises from within us. We have not only been encountered by God, we have seen God. We have heard God. So on this Valentine's Day, I want to remind us that God is love. This is a story about a God who loves us enough to reveal God's self to us, to show up, to unveil, not to stay hidden, to speak to us, not to leave us in the dark. When I was a young follower of Jesus, I worried about where I stood with God. Was I doing the right things? Did I go to church enough? Was I good enough? Was I in that book that God recorded all of my life in, with plus marks next to everything, with A's? Did I measure up? And in this story of Jesus and the two prophets and three disciples on the mountain, and one voice of God saying, "This is my son in whom I delight, listen to him," I can know where I stand with God. I mean, these disciples were a mess. I mean, come on, let's be honest. They didn't have their act all together all the time. They didn't get everything right. They didn't believe everything in the right way. They stumbled around. They spoke nonsense at times. Jesus smacked his head more than once. All that came out of their own limited understanding and the human condition. Yet, here, these very ordinary people, in all their humanness, get to witness a God who loves them enough to show up. Why does anyone send a Valentine card? Well, because it's not love until somebody actually says the words, "I love you." It's not love if somebody sends a Valentine's card and doesn't sign it. The point of the card is to show your love. It represents some deeper truth. Something sort of like that, you see, happened on this mountain. A story that's really hard to explain when it comes right down to it, but something like that happened. God's love for us was declared to us. It wasn't in a sappy Valentine's Day card, but through a suffering, loving God in Jesus. God loves us enough not to be hidden to us. You see, God shows up.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. I don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, but then again, no, or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. You can tell everybody that this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is on your end. Sat on the roof and kicked off the moss with a few of the verses. Well, they got me quite cross, but the sun's been quite kind while I wrote this song. It's for people like you that I keep it turned on. So excuse me for getting, but these things I do. You see, I've forgotten if they're green or they're blue. Anyway, the thing is, what I really mean, yours are the sweetest eyes that I've ever seen. And
you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind.